Assalamualaikum dan selamat kembali ke Fakir Fikir. Hari ini kita ada seorang tetamu yang sangat-sangat istimewa, iaitu Encik Ahmed Hussein. Encik Ahmed Hussein ni, his distinction is being one of the team members yang help Proton win the electric car race, betul?
Ya, oh, itu cerita lama tu.
Cerita lama, tapi semua orang ingat lah bila Proton menang the electric car race zaman Tok Kadok dulu, you were one of the team members, so which means that you were doing this way before kita semua terfikir tentang kereta elektrik.
Yes.
And on that note, apa kata kita mulakan dengan you cerita sikit tentang you punya background on how you became this EV kind of guy.
Okay, first of all, thank you very much, Saudara Samsul, to invite me lah to Fakir Fikir ni, program, I think about episode 7 tadi kan?
Episode 7.
Okay, so thank you very much to invite me. Actually, I started my professional career as an electrical electronics engineer in Proton R&D. Then later, got involved in advanced powertrain and control system development, which involved in the development of vehicle network and also hybrid and electric vehicle. So this is zaman cerita lama lah. This is way back in 2004, 20 years ago lah cerita ni. So after that, with that technical knowledge, through Micro Concept Tech, the company I founded, I started focusing on consultancy work and development and testing of electric and hybrid vehicle. And during these 10 years ni, I worked on multiple electric and hybrid vehicle prototypes and fleet vehicle with and also public road. This is both in Malaysia and also I think at that time in UK lah.
So maybe you boleh cerita sikit lah, since you dah mula buat benda ni lama kan. I tak ingat bila Proton menang Brighton, tapi awal 2000 Proton dah ada macam collab tak silap saya dengan Detroit Electric untuk buat kereta elektrik kan. So benda ni dah lama betul lah, you dah tahu benda ni dah 20 tahun, you nampak teknologi tu evolving. Maybe you boleh cerita sikit tentang apa the evolution in the technology yang melibatkan kereta elektrik.
Rightly say, kita masa dulu lah, masa di Proton, we were looking at electric vehicle ni since daripada awal dulu, we are converting Proton punya combustion engine vehicle into electric vehicle, but we did it step by step. We have the mild hybrid dulu. Mild hybrid tu maknanya kita buat start stop je dulu, still keeping the combustion engine, tapi with a starter system yang that we can achieve start stop, so we save energy or fuel from that way. Kemudian we looked into, at that point kita ada two technologies in electric vehicle, whether to use at first we looked at hybrid dahulu. So hybrid, and there were two technologies at that time. Satu dia panggil series hybrid, and another one is called parallel hybrid. So series hybrid ni, you can imagine you have an electric go-kart contohnya, macam kereta kita main golf tu, and then you put engine on top of it so that you extend the range of the electric vehicle. So that's series hybrid. Whereas the other technology at that time is parallel hybrid, where you have the internal combustion engine vehicle, but then you put electric motor kat dalam tu, so that it complements the combustion engine. So that were the technology we worked on. Kemudian only when the technology matures, electric motor punya technology mature, the battery technology mature, barulah at that time Proton kita look into electric vehicle, complete pure electric vehicle. And we worked with a few different, I would say, technology provider lah at that time. At that time EV ni very very new. We had to work with a research based company, a few of them, and every one of them, they had their own technology, and we were looking at which one is the best lah. That was what happened in Proton. To the extent of sampai satu tahap where actually we produce electric vehicle and hybrid vehicle, a fleet of them. Maknanya ada dekat, I think kalau tak silap, about 20 of them, that this vehicle were actually roadworthy. So memang dia duduk atas jalan raya, and it was being used by government agencies, you know, as a day-to-day punya kereta. So that was an achievement lah by Proton at that time.
So in terms of macam battery, macam motor tu, dah banyak berubah ke?
I would say memang significant. We are talking about lah over 20 years that I've been looking to EV ni, memang banyak berubah, significant improvement. You know, even the battery, masa dulu when we were looking at the battery, we were still looking at nickel metal hydride punya battery, right? Then, you know, upgrade, then we looked at LiPo, lithium phosphate, you know, that is the chemical itself lah, the chemical itself. But not to forget the control system. You know, how do you maintain, how do you, using electronics, using intelligence, how do you make sure that the battery can actually survive for a longer period of time and also at the same time safe to be used by normal consumer. Yang tu pun banyak lah sebenarnya improvement. That's on battery and also at the same time electric motor. So electric motor, daripada kalau zaman dulu kita cerita pasal DC motor, then we have AC motor, asynchronized motor and all sorts of technology. In the end, you get a much more efficient motor and you know running at higher voltage so that it is it has more performance, but at the same time loss less or more efficient actually.
So sekarang ni bila kita tengok car company, ada yang ambil approach buat clean design untuk dia punya kereta elektrik, dan ada yang ambil approach untuk do macam you ceritalah conversion ataupun they share the same platform untuk ICE dengan EV. So you have two in one. You punya pengalaman masa tu obviously tak ada, kita Proton tak ada design from the ground up punya electric car kan. So proses nak convert kereta biasa nak pergi ke kereta elektrik ni bukan untuk pengguna seorang individual je tapi untuk manufacturer tu, how difficult is actually the process and can or is that the easier way to do it than design a whole new platform?
Actually, because okay, the main thing bila kita cerita tentang the platform, the car platform tu, is the packaging. You know how you want to fit things together into the vehicle. Obviously, the size and number of components when you talk about ICE vehicle as compared to electric vehicle different. Contohnya, yang paling obvious engine lah. Engine, you got one big chunk of engine. As compared to kalau electric vehicle, you have to have motor, maybe slightly smaller, but then you have to have battery pula. So this consideration ni, I would say kalau macam contohnya, if there's no reason, you wouldn't want to design a platform yang ada kedua-duanya to support both, because it would be the development time would be longer and cost would be higher lah, because you can nak kena accommodate both kan. But masa zaman tu, I think it was Saga, if I'm not mistaken. Saga, the engineers at that time already thought about this. So they design the Saga tu such way that the platform tu is quite adaptable sebenarnya. Not perfect sampai dia jadi macam EV. Dia boleh jadi macam EV, boleh masuk terus battery pack and fit nicely. But there were consideration on the chassis on the platform tu that if we put battery, it's okay, boleh, maknanya without any problem. So with that sebenarnya, that's why when Proton started the technically conversion project lah, we did with Izora and Saga at that time, not so challenging in terms of packaging, easy lah juga.
What did they do to make the platform tu macam kind of EV ready? What was the differences between normal platform dengan platform yang dia orang design to make EV ready?
The actually because of the battery tu, kalau boleh battery kita biasanya kita nak dia as flat, as squarish, as wide as possible. Right? So to have that big chunk of thing inside the vehicle, you have to imagine dia kena ada void lah within that platform. Tak boleh ada benda lain kat dalam tu. Tak boleh ada, you know, tak boleh ada fuel line, tak, kalau nak letak dia punya arch, kena letak somewhere. So those kind of thing tu yang has to be considered much earlier on.
Saya ingat masa saya sebut.
Go ahead.
So masih sebut Saga, kata Saga tu dah masa tu dia orang dah macam fikir macam mana nak electrify benda tu. Then I teringat satu conversation ataupun satu soalan yang ditanya oleh media masa Saga dilancarkan, Saga baru ni. And one of the things yang the media notice was dia punya fuel filler flap tu besar, much bigger than we normally see. So kita pun tanya kenapa besar sangat fuel filler flap tu. Dan Azlan punya answer was, well, this is future ready. Future ready, what are you talking about? kita well, kalau you tengok charging punya port, dia besar tau, and dia memerlukan ruang yang besar sikit. So they design the fuel filler flap to be slightly bigger, but bigger big enough so kita nampak dan kita cam lah kan, kata, eh, besar ni benda ni kan. So masa tu kita macam, ya betul kan, apa benda cerita kereta elektrik ni. But you're, now bila you cakap ni, I'm thinking, oh, it's, I mean, Proton was already thinking ahead lah, but sadly, maybe too far ahead of its time, eh? So there's nothing that you can do about it at that time.
Unfortunately, betul-betul.
So sekarang ni, bila you tengok the landscape for EV, what are your thoughts?
Okay, first of all, kalau kita lah, kita compare 2-3 years ago dengan what we can see now, the availability of EVs in the market is significantly more. Kalau dulu, you know, you can choose from few different brands, boleh kira dengan jari je lah kan, lepas tu harga pun semua tak berapa marahin sangat lah, but now you have more choices, and the price is significantly lower, and most importantly sebenarnya, the car tu can be sold in Malaysia. Why? Because it meets international regulation. Sebab kalau dulu ni, kalau kita cerita dulu, bukannya tak ada electric vehicle, you know, in the other parts of the world. Cuma they exist, but they do not meet international regulation, automotive regulation that we follow, in Malaysia follow. So kita tak boleh lah, mereka tak boleh lah nak export to Malaysia, and we cannot you know, import it. But now that this car manufacturer, you know, the like of BYD, Chery, they know that if they want to enter the international market, Malaysia included, they have to meet international regulation and standards, safety standards. So when they are able to meet, tu yang kita nampak, you know, more and more car companies start selling in Malaysia. I would say it is good for the ecosystem. I would say it would be good for the ecosystem, and then good for the consumer lah. Consumer would have more options, you know, to start their first journey lah with the electric mobility. But I also really really hope kita punya local industry, you know, the design and development industry, can also follow through with them. Kita tengok orang lain boleh buat masuk, we can also do. Itu yang for me as an hardcore engineer ni kat Malaysia ni, I would really hope the industry, the design and development punya industry yang grow together sebenarnya, rather than just, you know, traders jual beli je.
Betul-betul. I mean, kadang-kadang bila orang criticize Proton dengan Pro 2, you know, kata macam-macam benda lah kan, menyebabkan harga kereta jadi mahal tu, saya terfikir juga sekejap kan, adakah orang-orang yang cakap macam ini dia orang tak berfikiran jauh, ataupun mungkin dia orang tak pernah kaji negara-negara lain yang ada industri otomotif. Sebab saya rasa almost every country yang ada industri otomotif, dia protect dia punya automotive industry, sebab automotive industry is a very important capacity builder kan. You have all sorts of skills in terms of engineering, marketing, legal, design, semua ada kat dalam tu. And like you said, Proton built up quite a significant pool of skill. So, I suppose kita kata the heyday of Proton lah, in the early 2000 until maybe 2014, 2015 tu. After that, kita dah tak ada lagi nampak produk-produk baru yang kita hasilkan sendiri. The last one was really the Persona dengan Iris lah kan, which is, to me, this is a very sad moment in time untuk the Malaysian auto industry. Tapi setengah orang dia happy dan seronok sebab harga kereta mungkin dah murah sikit. Tapi realitinya, kereta-kereta tu semua orang lain design, kita pasang je kat sini kan. Skills like the one that you have, kita tengok ramai juga kawan-kawan kita daripada Proton yang sekarang kerja dekat luar, and quite a few of them I tahu memang consulting untuk EV projects outside. And it would be great if ada visionary yang boleh pull back all of the skill to betul-betul push for the local EV industry.
Kalau if that happens, it would be great. You know, memanglah kita tahu we have to build our ecosystem in Malaysia. So the skills tu yang mana yang keluar, they have their reason. Probably their skill is required outside of Malaysia more than in Malaysia.
Yep,
so yep. Somehow someone kena try bring them back and try to restart balik lah kot.
Yeah, betul-betul. So one of the things yang orang complain pasal EV sekarang ni, big, the big concern lah kan. Ada mungkin kata tiga lah, tiga big concern. Yang pertama sekali of course harga lah, harga tu mahal. Dan yang keduanya dia orang cakap kat mana nak charge benda ni, dia tak nampak pun charger kat mana kan. Dan yang ketiganya of course lamanya nak kena tunggu nak charge kereta elektrik ni. So itu tiga benda yang menghalang EV lah kan. So what do you think the developments yang tengah berlaku dekat dunia EV ni, adakah boleh mengatasi tiga masalah utama?
Okay, actually in terms of cost tu, I really think it will go down. Yang tu actually we've seen it. You know, macam I explain tadi, kalau 2-3 years ago kita kata cheapest car berapa, 200,000-300,000. Now slightly more than 100,000 you get a decent EV. You know, ini range dia bukan main calang-calang ni. You're talking about 200-300,000 kilometers punya range. So so the price will go down, and we know it will continue to go down. Again, dia lah, cost ni biasanya bila the significant drop tu is either the technology improvement, you know, new cells, cheaper battery, new chemicals kan. At the same time, it's economic of scale lah. Betul. Lagi satu is the economic of scale tu. So the more, the when you have the economic of scale, you get that significant price drop lah. So I would say that will happen. Memang soon, as we've seen already. Kemudian charger. Pasal lah biasa orang komplain, you know, charger ni jauh, mana nak cari charger tak jumpa. I would comment this on two things. Nombor satu, okay lah, fine. The fear is the fear lah. So, masing-masing punya fear lah kan. Tapi sebenarnya kadang-kadang the, kita kata range anxiety tu, it is just an anxiety. It is not something real pun. Contohnya, I think because in the industry dulu, I think we're talking about maybe 10 years ago, bila EV yang bukan hybrid, EV first masuk kat Malaysia, my family lah, myself and the wife, we got the chance to become masa tu kita kata pioneer in driving EV on the public road. So, masa tu kita duduk di Sambayang Insya Alam, and the wife works in KL. Right? And dia dibagilah kereta EV ni untuk pakai day to day. So mula-mula dia pun risau lah, range dalam brochure tulis the car ni punya range is 80 kilometer je masa zaman tu. So boleh ke sampai office ni 80 kilometer ni kan? Duduk Shah Alam nak kerja kat KL ni. But it turned out to be, you know, daily use memang pergi kerja 40 kilometer. Lepas tu the office masa tu, dia office di KLCC. The charger in KLCC. The charge. Lepas tu sampai petang dia balik. So this goes on like almost 3 months without any problem. Tak ada pun cerita breakdown. Kan? Normal commuting lah, pergi balik kerja kan. Kerisauan tu sebenarnya tak ada. And then of course lah kadang-kadang nak you know, time office, after office dia nak pergi ke tempat lain dulu kerja kejap ke. There's enough juice lah in the car sebenarnya. Tu nombor satu lah in terms of range anxiety tu kadang-kadang it's not so real. Tapi okay, of course memang
I feel that bila people cakap pasal range anxiety ni, people like actually cakap, they're talking about like maybe 5% of their own driving requirement, iaitu driving on road trips, which is not something you do every day. Maybe you do like 5% of the time, so you're worried about that 5% of the time, tapi tak nampak the 95% of the time.
Exactly, you're right. Macam itulah kan. So that is why okay lah, kalau kita nak address that 5% anxiety, of course we have you know, charger. We know in Malaysia more and more charging station are being installed. You know, we have more players lah, CPO now on board. Kalau dulu we talking about mungkin ada 4-5 CPO saja. Now I think dah belas, if not 20 over CPOs. So this will provide them with sufficient charging station. Of course at the moment ni banyaknya dekat big city lah. Kemudian on the highway. That is one of the way to solve the range anxiety. Tapi at the same time, nowadays all the EVs range is we're talking about hundreds of kilometer, 200 to 300 kilometer. So itu dah jadi kira commuting no problem lah. Nak balik kampung setakat Melaka, Perak, okay lagi lepas single charge kan.
In fact sampai Penang pun lepas kalau you ambil long range cars, JB, Penang lepas. I think kadang-kadang kita orang lupa yang Malaysia ni taklah besar mana. Daripada JB nak pergi ke Penang tu dalam maybe 700 kilo at the most. And that's one charging stop. Kalau you betul-betul nak kena rushing ke apa ke, it's one solid charging stop half an hour. Which kalau you travel daripada JB pergi Penang, mesti berhenti lunch. Ini confirm lah kena berhenti lunch kan. Which will take more than one hour for most people sebab nak pergi nak makan, nak pergi solat, mungkin nak pergi whatever dulu lah, whatever your business in the washroom ke apa ke, then that's going to take one hour anyway. So, I don't know.
Sebenarnya itulah. I think it's more about giving the experience and more people talking about it. User talk about it, dia pakai, dia kata, tak ada masalah pun. Then everyone will start to realize that, oh, okay, this is something practical. Kan?
So, the other thing yang maybe mungkin orang tak faham about EV ni ialah because benda tu barulah. I tak suka, setengah orang dia get upset bila orang kata EV ni tak bagus, dia get all upset. So to me, I tengok benda ni from history, from the historical point of view lah. What I mean by that is that from the point of view of technology adoption. Technology adoption ni dia ada proses dia, dia bukan overnight jadilah. Yang paling cepat kita tengok berlaku adoption ialah benda macam internet, macam smartphone. Itu berlaku dalam tempoh kurang 20 tahun untuk smartphone, untuk internet mungkin within 20 plus years dah jadi prevalent sampai dia tak boleh nak buat apa lah, it's just everywhere. But dia ada, still ada proses. In the early days, semua orang tak faham lagi. Jadi semua orang akan garu kepala tanya apa benda yang kau cakap ni, and they will have all sorts of negative ideas and negative thoughts. Tapi bila kita sembang dengan people who baru beli EV, then it becomes immediately apparent that it's not the issue yang diorang sembang selama ni, sebenarnya bukanlah isu yang sangat penting. Contohnya macam charging tu, diorang tengok kata charging tak nampak banyak pun kat mana, dan bila kita tanya orang yang dah beli EV, dia kata I charge kat rumah. So the main thing sekarang ni is still from the Malaysian market is price lah. Yang itu memang betul-betul barrier. You rasa because kita tengok dekat China yang benda ni dah ada kan, how can the local industry cope dengan pricing daripada China ni? Sebab China supply chain dekat sana, so dia mungkin, that's why mungkin dia boleh build the car so cheap. Tapi kalau kita kat sini, boleh ke kita compete dengan mereka?
Okay, yang ini more on production ataupun supply ni, is something yang generally speaking, always kita akan slightly on the losing side as compared to, you know, the light of China is the economics of scale lah kan. They produce component in millions. We produce components in 100,000. So yang tu memang payah lah. I mean, it's just the cost of things. Tak boleh nak elak. Maybe we have, kalau for local industry, we have to figure out our own unique selling point. Aside from price, aside from cost. So maybe we should, you know, the components that we produce has better quality ke, ataupun meeting higher level of standard ke, those kind of thing lah. Price ni, I think there are people yang trying to do it. Frankly, at the moment, I'm not sure how many of them successful in beating the price. Ada lah kan, ada. Cuma not, I don't know how many of them. Ramai ke tak ramai, berjaya defeat ataupun get better price as compared to China.
If you, kalau kata kita nak communicate dengan public lah kan, tentang EV ni, apa you rasa aspek yang we should focus on yang mudah untuk orang faham?
Mudah untuk orang faham eh. I think nombor satu is, okay lah, bila when we talk about EV, assuming that the EV is something new ni, people will always say, oh, electric vehicle ni macam bunyi dangerous eh. You know, because kita daripada dulu, daripada kecil lagi duduk kat rumah, benda yang paling dangerous kalau kat rumah ni apa? Api elektrik. Luar tu je. Okay, nasib baik kita tak bawa kereta api. So fine, api tu tolak tepi lah, the safety. But kereta elektrik tu, they always imagine, okay, there is a high risk in electricity, in the use of electricity in car. Which is rightly, that's correct. You know, the safety yang kita, safety concern yang kita ada dekat dalam rumah, electricity tu, is also there in electric vehicle. So kita tak kata kat mereka, ni tak betul, mana di electric vehicle tak pakai elektrik. No, we say electric vehicle does use electricity. it does have kita kata high voltage risk. Tapi cuma apa yang kita perlu educate to the general public is sebenarnya this high voltage risk has been addressed. Dia bukannya kita main ambil je bateri, campur dalam kereta tu, boom, jalan. No, it has gone through significant amount of tests, significant amount of design actually, significant amount of design work, testing work, to meet regulation, to make sure that this high voltage risk ni is being addressed. Sehingga kan to the user, there is no risk. In a normal operating condition lah, there is no risk. So yang tu yang I think those people in the industry lah kena start educate the public sebenarnya, so that later anyway, very new future, bila depa dengar EV ni, to them it is just like, as far as safety is concerned, it is just like any other car. Tak ada beza pun, dia masuk dalam kereta, dia drive, dia tak ada pun risau, ada high voltage lah kat bawah kereta ni kan, dia tak ada risau benda tu dah. I think that is one of the key point lah, yang in terms of public perception kan, selain daripada range anxiety tadi tu.
Okay, as orang yang maybe observe the auto industry, kita kind of sort of understand what you're talking about lah, because nak design kereta ni macam-macam piawai nak kena lulus lah, and keselamatan tu memang one of the baseline yang you kena lulus lah. Macam you cakap lah kan, the product itself has to be not dangerous. So boleh tak you cerita sikit in simple terms yang untuk macam nak bagi orang layman ni faham, apakah antara benda yang industri buat untuk bateri dan untuk voltage, high voltage system tu yang menyebabkan dia jadi selamat? Because antara benda yang dia orang takut lah, which is you're right, elektrik ni benda yang kita paling takut lah. Sampai saya kalau nak buka, tukar apa nama plug dekat dinding pun, saya fikir 3-4 kali tutup satu rumah punya elektrik barulah nak pergi sentuh satu benda kecil. Kita memang takut benda tu. So one of the things yang orang takut ialah kalau kedah banjir nanti aku kena current, sebab bila elektrik tak boleh temu dengan air kan. Tu benda yang kita belajar daripada kecil, mak bapak kita ajar, semua cikgu pun cakap elektrik tak boleh kena air. So kalau masuk banjir macam mana, aku kejang kena current pula ke macam mana? Dan kalau hari hujan aku tak boleh charge kereta ke? Macam mana cerita? Okay. Cuba explain in like simple terms yang even people like me can understand.
Okay, simple. I try to make it simple lah. Okay. Betul kita kata the concern is real. The concern is real, memang betul lah. So that is why the concern of contohnya the electricity, the electrical equipment ni ataupun electricity lah, touching with water tu dah dipikirkan daripada awal lagi by the engineers yang developing the car. So mereka tahu memang these are risk. So how do we solve this risk? One of the way to do it is sebenarnya in terms of kita isolate all this electrical equipment, battery lah paling senang kita cerita. Battery ni dia akan so-called be waterproof. Senang cerita, paling ayat paling senang kita waterproof lah. Waterproof in a way that kita bukan saja air banjir. Kalau imagine air banjir ni, air is air static. The air banjir tu, air kita jalan kereta ni, kita jalan pun slow je kan, static air ni. So when we do test ataupun when we design battery pack sebenarnya, the kind of waterproofing that we're looking at is bukan saja air static, tapi kita tembak air. Meaning water jet the pack tu at high pressure. Mana air tu laju kuat lah. So you can imagine, So for the battery pack to pass the test, dia punya sealant, dia punya connector yang kita pakai tu is not just any other connector. Memang connector yang being designed, contohnya dengan rubber gasketnya, dengan double, kita kata ada double gasketnya. So such way that kalau kita tembak air ni, high pressure pun air tak masuk, confirm tak masuk. And benda ni is, benda tu akan jadi standard dalam regulation, standard yang semua manufacturer kena follow. Kalau dia nak bubuh connector pada bateri, okay, connector ni mesti meet water jet test of sekian specification parameters. So kita kata kalau benda ni, itu dari segi design. Maknanya design, engineer dah kena design battery pack tu ada connector-connector yang ada waterproofing sekian. Kemudian in the industry, we don't rely on design entirely. Any kind of design kita mesti akan verify. Verify ni bukan orang yang sendiri design tu verify, kita hantar pula kat orang lain. We send to a third party, terkata-kata terparti, please verify that my battery pack yang kita dah design ni is safe macam what I say. So terparti ni kita tahu dia tak ada interest in the design with the designer. So dia akan cuba destroy the battery pack. So dia akan tembak battery pack dengan air ni and try to make sure it actually breaks. Tapi kalau tak, doesn't break, doesn't leak, kita kata okay lah, battery pack tu pass lah. So this is the, kita kata the development and testing punya process yang the automotive industry goes through for every single component yang ada kat dalam kereta. So kita kata in the end, it is actually safe lah. Itu cara dia lah, how we address it engineering wise lah.
So what about charging masa hari hujan? Orang takut tengah nak charge tu, sekali yang hujan masuk dekat charging port, aku tengah pegang kabel ni dah lah macam besar semacam je kan, banyak elektrik ni.
And charging pun ada two things. Satu, nombor satu, charging in terms of dia punya connector dia, semua tempat penyambung dia akan ada same requirement macam hidup cerita bateri tadi. You know, it has to be waterproof and what not. Itu memang done, memang ada. Tapi besides that, the charging station and the car ni, dia while charging ni, dia sebenarnya dia continuously monitor dia ada masalah tak? Ada voltage leakage tak? Ataupun ada short circuit ke tidak? Continuously, ada air hujan ke tak ada hujan, dia akan continuously monitor. At the moment ada detect sedikit saja short circuit ataupun irregularities dalam dia punya voltage ni, dia akan terus cut off. So bila cut off, maksudnya the system tu akan safe lah. So these are the kind of, again, standards yang memang ada implemented in all the charging station yang ada kat Malaysia ni, that they have to follow. So kita kata, you know, nombor satu, conclusion dia, nombor satu, as it is, sebabkan all this, the component ataupun the connector yang digunakan tu memang waterproof, dia dah memang selamat. Nombor dua, kalau katalah betul lah ada kejadian, dia ada backup system yang akan cut off the whole system from short circuit. So kita kata double protection lah sebenarnya. Right? That is why sebenarnya I've never heard of kejadian yang user short circuit while charging. I tak pernah dengar lah. I don't know if you have, but I tak pernah dengar. So because of that reason lah sebenarnya kan. Because of that reason.
Yeah. And salah satu pengalaman charging saya yang saya rasa macam first time kita buat tu macam what? Kalau kita pergi dekat Kan Power punya charger, kalau tak silap saya. TNB punya, TNB Electron punya charger. Dia bagi tahu pin temperature. Cakap pin temperature, apa benda pin temperature ni kan? So the amount of detail yang sistem charging dengan kereta tu actually communicate is just so much more than orang macam saya ni faham lah. Kita tengok benda-benda tu macam apa benda ya dia nak kena cerita pasal benda macam ni kan. But obviously the system has been thoroughly thought through lah kan. Okay, so kita take a short break, dan lepas pada break ni kita akan kembali dan kita akan mulakan the real conversation dengan Cik Amir sebenarnya. Sebab Cik Amir ni dia ada satu kepakaran yang korang semua nak tahu. Memang semua banyak tanya kita pasal hal ni, dan saya tak boleh nak jawab sebab saya memang tak tahu apa-apa pasal benda ni. Tapi saya pernah tengok kerja Cik Amir, dan kita boleh tanya dia lepas ni, iaitu macam mana nak convert kereta korang yang bukan EV jadi kereta EV. Nah, aku tahu soalan ni ramai yang tanya sebab dia orang sayang kereta dia orang lah. Ini mungkin peminat-peminat kereta klasik, ataupun dia orang nak simpan kereta-kereta for sentimental reasons, ataupun dia rasa kereta yang elektrik baru ni semua boring, so nak simpan kereta yang lama. So we take a break and kita akan datang balik with that conversation. Alright. Okay, selamat kembali ke bahagian kedua episod 7 Fakih Fikir. Hari ini kita bersama dengan Encik Amir Hussein Jaafar. Dia ni pakar EV conversion. Dan sebelum kita teruskan, mungkin saya boleh tunjuk satu short video tentang EV conversion. Ini dia video ni, tunggu sekejap. So ni dekat Subang . Kat mana tempat ni?
Elmina.
Dekat Elmina. So memang dia orang buat EV conversion. Nah, ini kita pergi tengok the equipment ataupun bateri, motor dan apa yang nak masuk dalam Pajero JKR ni. Ini ialah projek yang Encik Amir buat dengan JKR kan, as a way of reusing kenderaan-kenderaan yang lama yang masih lagi elok tapi dah mungkin enjin dah terlalu lama nak maintain apa susah, and the conversion work is macam banyak juga lah benda nak kena buat. Pasal kalau kita tengok dekat YouTube tu nampak macam senang je kan. YouTube biasalah kan, semua orang tunjuk benda yang nampak macam senang kan, apa kita excited. Tapi maybe Encik Amir boleh cerita sikit maybe in detail lah tentang EV conversion ni, sebab you punya pengalaman macam kita tahu daripada awal tadi dah 20 tahun dah bermula dengan pengalaman you dekat Proton buat EV conversion untuk Proton. So cerita sikit.
Okay, so sebenarnya this is way back in 2022 bila ada a group of government agency iaitu GKR and also industry player Senggara Niaga invited me untuk work on electric vehicle conversion project. So bila kita dengar electric vehicle conversion project, I quickly say yes lah to work on this project, because I know there's a lot of challenges to address in this EV conversion project, both dari segi aspek teknikal dan juga regulation. So that's how it all started sebenarnya in 2022. Itu dah dia sebenarnya. Kita tahu dari segi even sekarang pun there is no formal framework ataupun guideline yang dikeluarkan oleh JPJ berkenaan dengan electric vehicle conversion. Mungkin something yang I can probably deliberate further. Boleh ke?
Before that, cuba cerita sikit. Complicated ke proses nak buat EV conversion ni? Sebab, like I said tadi, reason ramai kawan-kawan tanya sebab dia tengok dekat YouTube, biasalah dekat YouTube ni semua benda nampak macam boleh buat kat rumah. So, adakah it's a complicated process ataupun is there a way to simplify it? Cuma cerita sikit benda macam tu.
Okay, dari segi complicated ke tak complicated, complicated lah. Ini subjektif complicated ke tidak ni. Tapi okay lah, let's take the YouTube.
Okay lah, for you mungkin tak complicated lah because you're a trained engineer dan you tahu nak buat benda tu. But, try to put yourself in the shoes of the average person yang dia orang tengok video dekat YouTube tu dan dia tak ada real understanding about how this thing. Cuba maybe you can explain to that kind of audience lah, how complicated is this thing, how banyak step nak kena buat and all that.
Kita take the YouTube tu as a benchmark lah. YouTube as a benchmark. If whatever yang depa show kat dalam YouTube tu is easy, what is not shown sebenarnya is sebenarnya nak convert kereta, kalau katalah kita tengok YouTube tu is it is achievable, boleh buat lah sebenarnya. You do need technical knowledge, tapi sebenarnya dia boleh buat. Tapi what is not shown in the YouTube video is whether or not selepas you convert kereta ni, boleh ke tak kita pakai kereta ni on public road in Malaysia? Why? Because sebenarnya in Malaysia we are bounded to rules, peraturan jalan raya lah yang dikeluarkan oleh JPJ. That number satu, you cannot just simply tukar benda dalam kereta. You cannot just remove the engine, bubur elektrik motor, bubur bateri pun jalan atas jalan raya. You cannot do that. So sebenarnya the paling complicated to me, complicated is how do you make sure that the car ni is legal to use on the road. So itu sebenarnya proses yang tak nampak, yang banyak proses sebenarnya kena dilalui.
So the actual conversion itself doable by somebody with reasonable technical knowledge?
I don't want to mislead everyone. dari segi ability to do tu dengan sufficient technical knowledge, you can do it. Tetapi because I would say, okay, senang macam inilah, generally speaking, because electric vehicle is very new, okay, nombor satu, and because it involve high voltage ni there is a risk yang kadang-kadang orang tak nampak. Okay, kawan ni mungkin he has done conversion of normal car, tapi bila dia buat conversion of electric vehicle, this is totally different ball game, because of the components yang involve. It is not just now mechanical, you'll be involving high voltage punya component, and then bila high voltage component, dia ada safety to himself, the person yang nak buat kerja ni, and also bila benda tu dah siap, safety to the person yang nak pakai kereta tu. So benda-benda ni has to be taught lah. Of course dia boleh try baca here and there, tapi yang risau dia, not everyone in the internet tu duk cakap everything about what to do. So kat tu risau. So takut contohnya dia baca kat internet, dia baca buku, Contohnya, okay, dia tahu everything. Lepas tu dia nak start buat. Whereas dia tak perasan yang sebenarnya there's a lot of other things yang not being told. Itu sebenarnya yang kita merisaukan lah. Hence, that is why sebenarnya when we talk about conversion, if we want to really do conversion kat Malaysia ni, there are few things lah sebenarnya yang kita kena ada before we start. Contohnya, the person ni nak kena competent sebenarnya, and somebody has to prove that he is competent.
I paling ingat bila I pergi tengok your facility dekat Elmina tu, antara benda yang saya paling ingat sekali ialah masa you guys bawa tunjuk you punya equipment untuk sentuh kereta elektrik tu. It involves a little bit of specialist punya staff yang nak, I don't know, mungkin nak lebih kena electric shock lah kan. Ha? And then bila I tengok video dekat YouTube, bila Sandy Monroe ke Caresoft ke cerita tentang macam mana dia orang dismantle electric car battery, dia punya rule dia ialah dia kena buka first kali, dia kena shut off apa benda yang dia boleh shut off. Lepas tu dia akan discharge the entire battery, dan lepas habis discharge the entire sampai dia tak ada charge, they still treat that battery walaupun dia tak ada charge sebagai live battery, even though you dah connect everything. So to me nampak macam yang itulah yang paling utama sekali, first and foremost. As long as you ingat wire orange ni, kabel-kabel orange yang high voltage ni, jangan ambil mudah benda tu, it should be quite safe lah for you to work on this. Cuma of course that safety punya mentality lah. But bila I tengok, so let's talk a little bit about what we see in this video ni. Bila kita tengok, orang selalu fikir, alah, cabut enjin, pasang motor, cabut tangki minyak, letaklah bateri. Sebab mereka mungkin kecil-kecil dulu biasa main kereta bateri tu kan. So nampak macam lah mudahnya. And bila I tengok dekat sini, the conversion kit ni, macam, pasal apa ada radiator, kan? Ada gearbox pula kat situ. So, nampak like, maybe this is unique to this use case ke? Ataupun it's because belum ada like a proper kit yang kita boleh just install ke, macam mana ni, what's going on here?
Okay, so kalau katalah kita from that aspect, sebenarnya when we talk about EV conversion, sebab EV conversion is quite a generic term lah ya, sebenarnya. Before we even start dengan nak buat kerja conversion ni, there are lots of consideration yang kita kena buat. There's a lot of consideration. Contohnya, nombor satu is the final target specification. Contohnya kita nak kereta ni finally, what is the top speed, what is the acceleration, what is the gradability. Kemudian kita nak kena determine the charging performance, you know, berapa jam nak charge, lepas tu nak pakai AC charge ke DC charge ke. So all these questions has to be answered first. And kalau katalah kita tanya one person yang nak buat conversion dengan the other person nak buat conversion, kemungkinan besar jawapan dia lain-lain. Bila jawapan dia lain-lain ni, in the end, kalau contohnya kata I am a workshop, I want to do the conversion, I have to correctly pick component yang sesuai to meet this user punya requirement. So I tak boleh ambil kata satu bateri, satu motor, pukul rata kat semua kereta. Of course, that is something yang if we can do that in the future, that's good. Tapi at the moment, that is not the case lah. Satu spek berbeza. Lepas tu, the donor vehicle tu, kereta yang user nak pakai tu, dia nak pakai 4-wheel drive, 4x4 punya kereta ke, dia nak pakai van ke, dia nak pakai saloon ke, sedan ke. So, benda-benda ni semua akan memberikan kesan kepada komponen apa yang kita pilih. And hence, kalau kita tengok dalam the video ni, ada some of the component tu, macam contohnya radiator, masih ada. Kenapa masih ada? So that's why, sebab dia berkait dengan when we pick a component, kita kata, oh, okay, komponen ni motor contohnya, dia perlu beroperasi dalam temperature yang contohnya 90 darjah Celsius. So kita kena adalah radiator untuk nak maintain the cooling system contohnya. Kemudian kalau tengok video tu, ada tiba-tiba ada juga transmission. Dan kita kata, kenapa ada transmission? Tak boleh ke motor run direct kepada motor, kepada tyre kan? So again, it goes down to the specification ataupun I would say the apa yang nak dicapai oleh the client at that time. So in this case contohnya, at that time the client wanted the one of the key point dalam the project is kita nak the conversion being done but as minimal as possible changes to the vehicle. So yang mana benda yang tak boleh, tak perlu change, kita tak payah change. That was the kita kata the objective of the project. So that's why contohnya kalau kita tengok, transmission still ada, yang the 4x4 punya transmission tu, kenapa tak buang je? Tapi kita kata, memang the project tu nak kekalkan. And for the cost reason lah, dia tak nak beli transmission baru. So that's why dia macam tu. So it's a mix sebenarnya how the conversion finally look like. Itu sebabnya contohnya when we talk about competent person tu tadi balik, you know, if you look at the YouTube, ada beberapa contoh video YouTube that is being done for that particular car and to achieve his specific requirement. Tapi kalau kita pula nak buat dekat Malaysia ni, contohnya kita nak buat kereta kita, obviously our car is not the same as dia punya kereta. Right. The space yang ada dalam engine room tu berbeza. The space yang ada nak letak battery pack pun berbeza. Obviously specification pun mungkin akan berbeza. A competent person is the best person to be able to say, contohnya kalau nak capai spesifikasi begini, okay, kena pakai motor size begini, kena pakai battery size yang begini. Itu yang kena ada knowledge lah benda tu.
Kan? But how realistic is it? Because kadang-kadang macam you cakap lah, the use cases are very very different lah according to pengguna yang nak buat the conversion tu. Setengah orang ataupun ramai juga yang nak convert kenderaan lama yang klasik yang mungkin ada sentimental value. Mungkin not necessarily klasik tapi ada sentimental value. So for them, mungkin kenderaan tu dia tak bawa hari-hari. Mungkin bawa seminggu sekali je ke hujung minggu saja. So ada pula juga yang ingatkan dia boleh convert dan nak boleh pakai hari-hari. Are those two objectives possible dengan EV conversion?
Yes, I would say yes, it is possible. Sebab dengan EV conversion, katalah we talk about, kita simpan tepi kejap klasik car ni, klasik car punya idea, but EV conversion as a whole sebenarnya, when we convert a car into electric vehicle, when we convert an internal combustion engine car into an electric car, so sebenarnya bila dia dah jadi EVC ni, you can have the performance yang sama macam a purpose built EV. You can have, it's a matter of choosing the right component and the right battery pack size and specification. So kalau kita dapat, kita boleh source, memang boleh dapat sama macam purpose built vehicle. So yang tu something yang we have to have in mind. Kemudian kalau kita cerita pula dengan classic car, so this is giving the best of both. Sebenarnya you want to, the classic car tu kita nak simpan tu for big reason lah, sebab we love the car, we want the look, kita nak the classic look. Tapi contohnya, you know, the system, the engine contohnya dah tak boleh nak maintain, dah susah nak cari spare part. Okay? So if we take conversion, electric vehicle conversion into, you know, we mix them together dengan this classic car, we can get both. Kita dapat kekalkan the looks of that classic car, but at the same time, there the new, kita kata powertrain system, ataupun ada new system yang boleh menggerakkan kereta tu balik. And bila kereta tu bergerak, dia punya performance just like any other new electric vehicle. So boleh dapat the range yang dia nak, and even kadang-kadang top speed, you know, dengan electric vehicle ni, performance especially acceleration, you can be better than combustion engine. So tiba-tiba this classic car yang semua orang duk tengok apa slow sangat kereta klasik ni, tiba-tiba this classic car will be like the fastest in your town, kan? So you can get both, and it is practical sebenarnya. So for daily use ke, nak commute ke pun boleh, no problem.
So even kalau you seorang yang ahli dalam bidang ni pun kata it's a possibility for just the average workshop nak carry out nak EV conversion ni. So it seems like EV conversion is something yang maybe Malaysia should look closely at as a way to bolster kita punya local auto industry lah, to develop skills. Because I am somebody yang betul-betul percaya dengan tinkering ataupun nak bega-bega benda ni lah as a way of developing real skills. And kita tengok negara-negara yang mempunyai keupayaan besar dari segi technical, sama ada di Europe ke, di US ke, di Jepun ke, di mana ke, dia orang ada banyak tinkerers. And that's bila kita tengok dekat YouTube tu, tinkerers tu lah orang yang buat macam-macam benda ni. And sometimes benda tu bermula daripada situ. Tapi macam you cakap tadi, kat Malaysia ni, kalau kau terror pun, kau convert pun, kau engineer ke, kau apa ke, tetap kereta tu tak legal kat jalan. So, apakah cabaran ni sekarang ni? Macam mana kita nak, what do we do?
Okay, so, you're right dah. Memang macam I kata tadi lah, dia apa pun terror macam mana pun, in the end, tak boleh run the road because it is not legal. For this sebenarnya I think maybe you can take everyone into the perspective of things. Di Malaysia ni kita kata any car lah, bukannya conversion, even, you know, kereta-kereta baru yang datang daripada China ataupun yang kita build ourselves in Malaysia ni, dia has to go through type approval process with GPG. So in short, type approval process ni macam mana? Dia akan check this vehicle manufacturer ni have gone through significant regulation compliance punya effort to make sure that the car ni is safe to be used by the public on the public road. So ini even normal car, internal combustion engine pun has to go through the same situation. And then kemudian within the same framework, kalau katalah someone you want to upgrade your car, a normal car ni daripada 1.5 liter engine, you nak upgrade kepada 2 liter engine contohnya. So this is possible in Malaysia. Tetapi if you want to do that, you have to go through, you have to follow a defined guideline. Memang ada guideline khas yang kata, okay, if you want to upgrade kereta daripada 1.5 kepada 2 liter engine, you have to make sure scan. You have to make sure kereta you boleh buat scan. And after you've already comply with this guideline ni, you have to bring your car ni to JPJ again and to go through this approval process lah, to make sure sebenarnya apa yang JPJ nak pastikan is that your car ni yang you convert ni, yang you upgrade daripada 1.5 kepada 2 liter ni, is safe for you to use and also safe for the other public. So kita kata this guideline then the safety requirement yang JPJ ada ni is good. It's good for public reason lah, for public safety reason. Tetapi when we talk about converting internal combustion engine kepada electric vehicle, this is a different ball game. Why? Nombor satu, because of the high voltage punya risk tu. High voltage punya risk. And because of this high voltage risk, JPJ believe that there should be a new guideline. A new guideline that should address this safety requirement before you are able to convert. Tapi at the moment, this guideline ni masih tak ada. That is why bila dah tak ada, kita yang nak convert ni, kita nak follow apa? Because there is no guideline kan? Even though how good we are, kita boleh buat pun, because there is nothing from the authority yet, we can't do as what the authority wants. So tak bolehlah kita nak hantar to get approval to use on the road. So this is a problem lah sebenarnya. Memang a situation currently in Malaysia with regards to electric vehicle conversion. Sebenarnya.
So kita faham lah JPJ punya concern, macam cakap, is primarily about safety. Dia orang tak nak nanti kalau apa-apa jadi dia orang yang kena marah kan.
Betul.
So and safety ni and compliance ni, orang biasa dia probably tak faham kot nak buat macam mana. Sebab saya rasa kalau you nak pergi buat compliance for anything, nak even nak buat halal compliance pun, proses tu complicated dan memerlukan macam-macam. Tambah lagi lah compliance untuk satu produk yang complicated macam kereta ni. Jadi adakah ia memerlukan industri untuk come up with a suggestion untuk JPJ? Sebab adakah subject matter expert themselves yang kena come up with the idea? Because this thing is benda baru. Nobody wants to touch it with a 10-foot pole, right? So everybody is looking for somebody to blame in case something goes wrong, right? Nobody wants to say, okay, this is the way it should be in case, yeah, kau yang cakap macam ni okay, ni kau apa-apa jadi kau yang nak kena marah kan? So I nampak the reason kenapa I tanya soalan ni is sebab kalau kita tengok all this hot rod and custom car punya program dekat TV, which is mostly done in the US lah, where those vehicles are legal to be driven. Now kita mungkin tengok benda tu, kita kata, oh, dekat US dia orang punya rules very relax. Tapi sebenarnya when we look at dia orang punya conversion, bila kita dengar dia punya conversation masa dia buat conversion tu, typically dia orang akan beli frame baru untuk buat conversion kan, untuk hot rod. They'll buy a brand new frame, and that brand new frame comes from manufacturer yang memang specialized buat frame. Tu dia akan beli rear suspension, and then rear suspension tu memang datang from a manufacturer yang specialized buat suspension. So they have built up the custom industry, the hot rod industry, into kind of a modular plug and play industry. That's what you can see lah. You boleh buy American Axle, you boleh buy chassis daripada siapa. All these things you boleh beli, but they are not bought from somebody belakang rumah dah. These are from proper factories done by proper engineers. They are properly certified. All these parts are properly certified. So in my mind, I nampak benda yang sama jugalah perlu berlaku untuk kita di sini. Sekarang ni masalahnya budak-budak buat conversion motor kat rumah, the bike might well be safe. It might well be safe. Kan kita tak tahu. They probably pasal dia takut dia dah over engineer it, use more material than is needed, welding lagi banyak. It's probably safe, maybe. Tapi siapa yang nak bantu dia nak convert, dapatkan the paperwork? And because it's so difficult, they all punya attitude untuk custom bike ni, well, custom is underground anyway, so kita underground lah. Kalau kena tahan dengan polis, kena tahan dengan polis lah. Tak nampak macam mana kan. So, but I don't think that should be the case untuk EV conversion. So, is that something that you think the industry should do? Because I cembang juga dengan kawan-kawan daripada car company, whether they think that it's useful untuk come up with conversion kit untuk say Saga ke Kancil ke whatever lah kan. But then again, I don't know what the cost are in getting something like that commercial production. Maybe you boleh cerita sikit.
Okay, so I think you make a good reference to America. I think it's because of the maturity of the industry. Memang bukan yang kita nampak tu tiba-tiba dekat belakang rumah je dia buat conversion. Tapi sebenarnya where they source the component tu is not from calang-calang. You're right. So I think that is the biggest difference between what they have in the US, in the States dengan kita kat Malaysia. Our ecosystem is still, I would say, new. We are building our ecosystem. When we are new, I think we definitely need to have guideline to make sure that it is being done safely. Hence why kita kata tadi, as I said tadi, guideline tu penting. And actually we know at the moment, kalau kita cerita tentang EV conversion ni, we know at the moment there are automotive and regulation experts within government agency like Nano Malaysia and also JPJ that are currently looking at the regulatory framework for EV conversion. Kita tahu. But we know that, not released yet. Separately, in my opinion, as the industry player ni, I would say in addition to the guideline yang JPJ akan keluarkan to make things safe, also to accommodate yang normal people yang nak buat conversion ni, I think we need at least three aspects. Which these three aspects ni, actually we've tested. These three aspects yang I akan cerita ni, these finally became my guideline for us to do the conversion untuk JKR. Because bila kita buat dengan JKR dulu pun tak ada guideline juga kan, you know, from some JPJ tak ada. So we had to draft our own guideline. So when drafting this guideline, we do lots of research and benchmarking. Finally kita kata these three main thing ni perlu ada to accommodate dari segi safety and also to make it happen practically. So nombor satu sebenarnya dari segi komponen yang kita that we are going to use for the conversion. So this component ni has to be what we call a type approved component. Maknanya component that had gone through a sufficient amount of testing, design and testing, and follows the regulation, follows the specification. Tu satu, nombor satu. Must be type approved component. Maknanya tak boleh calang-calang component lah. So bila cerita tadi, kalau ingat cerita pasal connector yang waterproof apa semua tu, kalau type approved component, the components will be waterproof. For example. So itu settle. Dari segi komponen, must be a safe type approved component. Nombor dua, we say at the moment, this conversion ni has to be done by qualified personnel. So what do I mean by qualified personnel ni? Bila kita kata kita terror ni, of course we could be contohnya short sendiri. Kita kata kita terror tapi sebenarnya tak terror pun. So what is qualified personnel ni? Maksudnya bila kita kata kita terror, we need somebody else to say that we are who we are. Qualified. Maknanya kena ada third party.
Amang kata aku no. Amang kata aku no.
Okay, so itulah dia. I mean there must be a third party with an objective way untuk to assess you to say that okay, you are qualified, you know what you're talking about. Brother Samsul, we know what you're talking about contohnya, and after you prove that you can do something, kita bagi exam sikit-sikit, then okay, kita kata okay, you are qualified personnel. So nombor dua, kita kata it must be a qualified personnel, bukannya not just anybody that kata dia terror ataupun shock sendiri lah. Okay, and nombor tiga, I would say it has to be done in an accredited workshop. Maknanya tak boleh buat belakang rumah. So accredited workshop ni macam mana pula cerita dia? Kita kata accredited workshop ni is also a workshop that can prove that it has all the equipments, ada PPE, personal protective equipment yang high voltage, punya safety equipment and whatnot. Dia ada equipment-equipment yang betul. And last but not least, sebenarnya this workshop ni kena being accredited by third party, by authority lah. Contohnya maybe like JPJ contohnya. Okay, dia datang inspect, dia tengok okay, your punya workshop ada equipment sekian-sekian, and you have the personnel yang ada yang qualified, and the procedure yang you use for conversion pun define, boleh pakai komponen apa semua ni, and you know what to do. Contohnya di workshop ni patutnya dia yang tahu. Contohnya okay, nak buat conversion, lepas buat conversion ni kena hantar testing. Lepas buat testing kena hantar ke JPJ untuk buat approval. So this workshop kena tahu. So barulah kita kata the whole EVC punya work ni dia ada lengkap and can be safely done. So dua lah, satu safely done and can make it easy lah untuk orang yang tak tahu macam mana nak submit JPJ punya borang apa semua. You let the workshop do it because they know what they what to do, you know how to submit the forms and whatnot. What regulation to fulfill. Itu dia sebenarnya. Tiga benda.
So maybe benda ni semua nampak macam the what you said just now is betul lah. Cuma adakah sebenarnya EV conversion ni ialah an industry yang ada potential? Sebab bila you cakap all these things, which is true, you could require requirement, require component yang certified. Itu semua involve industrialization process lah kan. It's at the very least commercialization process and industrialization process yang mahal. So do you think ada tak ruang untuk EV conversion ni nak jadi useful component of the automotive industry moving forward? And what do you think Malaysia punya role can be in that? Sebab kalau kata kita nak compete maybe head on against big manufacturers, big countries yang ada the entire supply chain, mungkin susah. But maybe can this be like one area where maybe kita boleh shine?
I think you pointed out the question and then the answer sendiri, you jawab sendiri tu sebenarnya dah bagi answer. Nombor satu, is there potential economic benefit of EV conversion? I would say there is. Ni assuming finally JPJ keluarkan guideline lah. Finally kita ada guideline that we can follow, blah blah blah. There is a potential economic benefit. Nombor satu, because now you can imagine when we do conversion ni, the base car tu dah ada. So meaning all the cost to do dengan the base car, the 12 volt system, you know, the body, the cermin dia, the wiper, semua tu dah ada. So we don't need to have extra cost to it. So the only cost yang tinggal is only the EVC component punya barang. And this is we are talking about from our studies. We are talking about between 50 to 150,000 punya cost. And this is very kata dependent on the specs that you want lah for your car. And you want your range to be longer, pay slightly more lah because you need the bigger battery kan. Or you want your hot rod ni, you want your classic car to accelerate very very fast, you know. 100 meter in 6 second ke, you have to spend in a bigger motor, more expensive. So it's all your preference lah sebenarnya. Tapi generally speaking, the cost can be cheaper as compared to obviously a pure electric yang purpose built car. So with that sebenarnya, I can see dari segi industri, there is a gap that EVC ataupun EV conversion ni can fit in. Yeah, especially for those. Dua lah, satu, kita ada a few lah contohnya. Tadi rightfully is the classic cars. Classic car tu tak boleh apa lah, nak beli kereta baru dah tak klasik lah. So classic cars, there's a second life to your classic car. We do conversion. So that's one potential economic punya benefit. Number two is contohnya for those yang ada big fleets of vehicle. So dia dah ada big fleet of vehicle, nak replace all with new vehicle probably too costly. So they can opt for conversion. You know, pay fraction of the cost, but you get your car, you know, you give a second life to your car, your fleet, another maybe 5 years to it. So that is also another economic benefit lah. And lagi satu is the normal user, you know, normal user that dia rasa okay, dia memang ada kereta, tapi you know, day to day dia pakai, dia tahu the cost is such. Tapi he wants to try and reduce the operating cost, fuel cost. So also dia boleh go for this conversion. So memang ada. And dari segi, I would say dari segi engineering wise, kita kata industri lah. Tadi kita cerita consumer kan. For the industry, we have been trying to compete with other automotive manufacturer. Yang besar lah, biasanya kita in Malaysia, we try to fight with the small one, we try to fight with the big ones. And the situation is, we know it is very difficult for us to go against yang the big guys. Satu, teknologi slightly forward. Tapi because of the economic of scale tu, their cars will always be cheaper than ours. Okay. So is there another way to so that we can still be relevant in the industry? I would say EVC conversion could be one of it. Well, I could say EVC can be one of it. So instead of going head to head dengan diorang to produce one complete purpose-built EV, maybe we should have an industry of electric vehicle conversion kit, right? And if we are the first, we might be, you know, we can start ahead. I mean, first in Southeast Asia lah contohnya lah. So we can be ahead and we can we can start building our ecosystem in Malaysia, our technical expertise in Malaysia. So by doing so, and then we can slowly get the economics of scale, and then things can be, I would say, in the end, good for the consumer, kan?
Yeah, yeah. Well, the reason why I personally rasa benda ni memang ada huge potential ialah because for a large chunk of the world, the conversion, the cost of getting a new vehicle is very, very high. And kalau kita boleh lead the way untuk South America, in Africa, in the Indian subcontinent, in the Middle East, untuk buat conversion untuk orang yang the average person ni, I think that is just bukan saja economic benefit, but there'll be a fantastic service to the world lah that yang kita boleh provide to the world. And I betul-betul harap that whatever that you're doing dengan JKR ke ataupun mana-mana lagi organisation in trying to get the conversion guideline through ni will be successful lah. But is there like anything yang you nampak yang mungkin jadi sticky point lah in terms of the conversion process tu? Apa yang particularly difficult nak draft as the rule for conversion tu?
The rule for conversion, I think kalau in the industry, nombor satu, okay lah, regulation tu kita cerita banyak kali dah, you know, to so that the component yang kita pakai tu has to be of a certain standard, meeting the type approval. But besides that, I think is finally the safety of the vehicle lah. The safety of the vehicle. Because at the end of the day, of course lah, kita buat engineering apa semua ni, at the end of the day, what is it to the user? User okay, dapat jimat cost, dapat reduce the cost, dia dapat kereta half baru ni, but then making it safe is paramount. There's no two about it, mesti dulu. So how to make it safe, be it lah masa tengah nak buat conversion, and finally bila kita dah the user is using it, yang itu yang I think more effort has to be put in. And I think this is what is being discussed sebenarnya, you know, by the Malaysia, by JPJ, by MOT, and our partners ni, macam mana nak make sure bila kita buat ni it is safe and there is no kejadian in the future that will haunt us nantilah. I think that's probably the thing lah sebenarnya.
So I agree with everything that you say, and bila kita nak jadikan benda ni more widespread tu, nampak macam tadi benda yang kita buat gelak tadi lah, qualification of the people yang nak buat the actual conversion tu at the end of the day. Sebab of course you boleh design the component, get it certified and whatnot, but the actual conversion will still have to be done at smaller facilities lah, kan? Workshops and maybe specialist facilities yang buat the conversion tu. And it has to be made as simple as possible to reduce the risk of error, nak menjadikan benda tu selamat lah, kan? I think that's where for the government punya side, of course, is dia punya concern is safety, sebab tak nak nanti orang blame dia for not putting in the correct safeguards. For industry, basically bila you design kereta biasa pun, I think but this is the reality lah, you have to design the product for the most stupid person who will use it, kan? It has to be made foolproof. So yeah, sama lah benda ni, you nak buat komponen untuk EV conversion ni kena buat for the most stupid mechanic yang boleh somehow still pass the qualification, tapi memang bengap lah dia ni, kan, have no common sense, just to make sure that dia benda tu tak jadi masalah basically. But then again, benda ni pun kita pun dah belajar bila kita tengok orang buat kereta, kan, Toyota punya sistem di mana you can only fit component one way, kalau the other way dia tak boleh masuk, kan, that's the only one way you can do it. So yeah, okay, maybe we can close on that, and on that note, atau macam mana kita nak buat supaya satu, it's safe and it's foolproof and easy untuk orang buat conversion.
So I think you rightly say, I think on that note sebenarnya we know, I mean, in Malaysia ni sebenarnya we do have experts. I do believe we do have experts in the industry, in the universities, that know that this is the kind of thing yang is good if we can embark on, you know, to put more research on making sure that it is safe, it is foolproof and whatnot. But I think what is also required is the backup from the government in terms of funding. You know, I really hope contohnya nanti ada more research lah, more, I would say, budget is being pumped into the industry to look into these areas sebenarnya, to get things going.
On that front, I think it's everybody's punya job to convince the government that this thing has economic potential lah, dan baru dia dah nak buat itu sebagai serius, dan barulah they will move, create the framework untuk benda ni boleh operate properly. This is normal lah untuk anything pun sama aja. We just need to convince them that ni ada economic potential, and everybody yang ada interest in this thing should come together and ceritakan lah. And also the other thing, kadang-kadang bila as a journalist ni, I banyak sembang dengan orang yang pakar lah. Saya ni fakir fikir, bukan tahu apa pun. Tapi bila sembang dengan orang yang pakar ni, kadang-kadang, of course when you talk to pakar in a particular field dah 2-3 kali, kita dah tahulah apa yang sebenarnya yang dia nak cerita. Tapi because they are experts, some of the things yang dia buat tu, to them is so obvious that dia tak nak mention pun kat kita, sebab dia takut dia wasting our time. Things like macam making things foolproof ni, memang kalau you sembang dengan engineer kereta dia, of course lah it's foolproof. What do you mean? Of course lah, kan? You think kita tak fikir ke tentang nak shot masuk air ni? Kan gila ke apa? You stupid. You know, dia punya, of course the attitude is like that lah kan. Because it's so obvious kan. Takkanlah aku nak design kereta yang kalau masuk air kau mati kena shot. Karen tak masuk akal benda tu kan. But benda tu sometimes sounds so stupid and so simple, but it bears repeating because your world and the world of people yang pakai produk you is so different. The world right now is so industrialized that the average person, apa saja objek yang dia pegang dalam rumah dia, dia tidak ada kefahaman tentang macam mana benda ni sampai dekat dia pun. Dan dia tak ada kefahaman tentang all the millions of people yang involved to get this to their place, you know. Because this is kita ni reporter ni macam transformer juga. I have to bring the level to where my readers are. Sebab kita punya training ialah, can a standard 6 boy understand this or not? Can a standard 6 student faham tak apa yang aku tulis ni? So that's just something yang kita need to use as the common language lah, yang semua orang boleh faham. Whether we're going to talk about whether this thing economically viable, economically desirable, safety can be done, we have the capability, semua. I think we just need to say it in simple ways and don't get upset when people don't understand it, because this is something yang memang susah nak faham sebenarnya. And kadang-kadang benda ni kena ulang dan ulang dan ulang dan ulang berpuluh-puluh kali. And I know people technically inclined people, they get quite quickly frustrated bila dia cakap orang tak faham. But that's you have to understand that it's normal, because your world is very different from my world. And I don't understand. Kalau aku duduk sebelah Encik Amir pun tengok apa dia buat kerja, maybe aku faham maybe 5%. Bila dia pegang screwdriver, aku faham lah apa dia buat. Dia bawa keluar kadang-kadang benda meter-meter semua, aku tengok apa benda yang hang ukur aku pun tak tahu. Aku tengok ajalah, senyum je kan, macam tahu. But this is the reality. The gap in terms of understanding is very big. This is a very new technology. And I hope to get more experts like you guys to come on and explain in really simple terms what is happening. Okay, I think sampai situ. Encik Amir, ada apa-apa closing words yang you nak mungkin mention? In this regards, in terms of conversion and whatnot.
Okay, I think on the note, continue to what you say lah. Sebenarnya for us in the engineering fraternity ni, sebenarnya we are happy that there are someone like yourself that is trying to, you know, reword whatever we say so that it's understandable to the general public. So ni kalau kita dulu, I think there's a term for it. Engineering communicator ataupun science communicator. So I think you are one best person to do it. Alhamdulillah, we have you in Malaysia to help us. That's one. And then for as a last note lah, when we talk about the EVC tadi tu, electric vehicle conversion, I think the industry, the authorities and the industry player who has influence in driving the EV conversion initiative should actually really, really look into how to make this EV conversion safe and legal, despite all the current steep challenges that we already know. You know, regulation, guidelines, safety, crashworthiness, lack of expertise, difficult to get that approval, and so on. Banyak lah. Okay, because the struggle is real. But if we don't continue making progress, then there will be more uncertainties and things will never happen. I think
Sorry for interrupting.
No, I think that's my last note lah sebenarnya.
Okay. So okay, you guys minta, ampas pun minta nak nak cerita tentang conversion. Kita dah cuba bawa dah pakar-pakar ni. So sekarang ni kita minta tolong sikit, ampas share lah dengan kawan-kawan yang lain yang mana berminat tentang EV conversion ni, yang nak tahu lebih mendalam lagi tentang proses penghasilan EV. Kita dah ada somebody yang memang tahu benda ni dan dia dah cerita quite in depth macam mana how EV are designed and macam mana kita nak buat conversion dan semua. So tolong kita sikit dapatkan lebih banyak traction. And then of course yang mana belum subscribe, of course ramai yang belum subscribe kat YouTube ni, typically 60-70% orang yang tengok tak subscribe, tekan butang subscribe tu dan tekan butang loceng supaya tak ketinggalan lah bila kita buat yang video-video yang terbaru ni. Kita jumpa lagi.